come into a remarkable universe and world. In a world where what we truly are can be more clearly seen and experienced. I am very happy to be here in the front of Gabriel Soga Caciula and near Cristina Comanac in approximately 1 hour of a great chance for reaching ourselves through a great tradition, the Japanese tradition, and the essence representing the tea ceremony. As we already started, and we may see, ladies and gentlemen, it's quite a special mood, a special way of being. Usually, we are very expressive, and we used to do gesture and so on to be active. But as I see it and I feel it, look at you, Gabriel.
I cannot see myself, I have to tell you.
Yes, yes. Quite another way of being.
I think it's the way at which one arrives naturally through practice. I'm not sure what that way of, that is perceived as the quietness of silence, of movement or lack of noise, of behavior. I'm not sure what that is, but certainly it is a way of behavioral attitude which is developed through practice.
More than 30 years of practice?
In my case, yes.
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 You learn from the roots in Japan and in United States. In fact, you are an American citizen living now in Europe. Yes.
Yes. I'm what people today would call a mutt, a stray dog on a lost land. I was born in Romania. I lived in the United States for quite a period of time, and then I moved back to Europe. And while I was in the United States, I had the chance to work in Japan, and there I met the tea ceremony in the tradition of Urasenke, as there are many other traditions. All of them, though, are coming from one source, at least symbolically and historically, we love to say one source. Because in the 15th century, it was a group of people that happened to be there because it was their time, who brought together the ritual of tea in temples. They stripped the extravaganza of orgies that the aristocracy in Japan had, drinking tea lavishly. And they brought it together to a form of decency, a sort of middle way. Mm-hmm. And that is how, at that time, CHANOYU was formed.
And from since then?
Since then, with CHANOYU, everything that happens is a sum of contradictions that appear unsolvable, but always there is a way out.
A sum of contradictions?
It is a ceremony of contradictions, as it is Zen, as it is probably everything. But since then, one of the contradictions is that it didn't change much. So what we do today, at least in the kata, in the form, it is very much as it was in the 16th century. Saying that, one of the questions that really pops up at once is what happens with the spirit? At that time, it was developed by monks, by Zen monks. At that time, people felt and understood the world in a different way, had a different sense of aesthetics and ethics. 500 years later, we are living in a world that is so much different, but we are practicing and we are reproducing the same form. So I always question myself, to what degree do we are we capable of truly feeling the spiritual value, or are we in fact just doing at times a mockery?
So what are, in what consists the spiritual values then? Are there beyond cultural time and spaces? What's spiritual?
Well, this is one of the moments when that silence of movements and speech mm-hmm. shows up. It is a very complex
question.
Questions are quite probably
quite silly question. In fact, is not a question. Maybe.
Yes. Today we use the word spirituality in a different sense. Years back it was a sense, a religious sense. It was related to the soul.
Soul.
It was strictly a metaphysic domain. Today it has so many meanings, and it is easily associated with a like form of humanism, of entrepreneurial success. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Today a spiritual person may be an intellectual that speaks nicely, it is well-educated and well-mannered.
Of course.
And in fact, he may not be spiritual at all. Mm-hmm. If we look back, he would not believe in a metaphysical analysis. So spirituality is a difficult space. And nevertheless, we have it in us. We have a soul, or we have something that makes us be aware of ourselves. We have this incredible thing that I don't know what it is, consciousness, and we have to deal with that. And people deal in a different way. And I think the tea ceremony is a sort of heaven speaking in the Judeo-Christian way, which I shouldn't, a heaven of getting together in a sort of a synergetic way, a refined sense of aesthetics. It is this refined sense that one develops in dealing with things in a proper way. And we learn what the proper way is at the beginning by asking questions, at which our teacher would say, just shut up and practice. Mm-hmm. And there is a lot of truth in that. We asking questions is in fact expecting answers that you already have, and you need confirmation. So you cannot ask questions not because somebody stops you, but because you are not yet there to ask the question. And when you are there is no need to ask the questions because you know.
So let's try it. Sensei, this is a glass of water. To catch the glass of water in a proper way. What's mean the proper way? So I don't know what's the proper way. I was thinking if I already have the answer. Mm. One answer will be, of course, because my mind is very smart and closed. Mm. No answer, no question, no teacher, no nothing. Is to take it with like this, with two hands, and trying to have the experience of being with the water. But saying this, it's already the proof that I'm not able to feel what I'm talking about.
The proper way.
Yes, in the proper way.
Well, here comes the contradiction. When we say proper way, certainly we frame it within a confined space, the space of a culture. Mm. So it may be that in an Arabic culture, mm-hmm. there is a proper way, which is not in the Japanese culture, and is not in the German culture, or the Western culture. So we have to accept that the proper way, it is viewed in the concept of the Japanese way of behavior, of understanding nature and things as being altogether one with us.
The oneness.
However, when it comes to getting a glass of water, the question is, do I take it with one hand or with two hands? And here, the culture says, Well, if it is a valuable object, you display this value, not because you display it, because it comes naturally after a feeling of, oh my God, this is precious, not to break it. You would take it with two hands, and you'd carry it at a lower height, God forbid, to drop it. So you have to carry it with it. Then you'd hold it on one hand and carefully, almost not touching it, put the second hand. So the idea is don't touch it because your dirty hands, they are clean. But your clean, dirty hands touch something that is sacred. This is with an object of value, and that would be a Chinese object.
A Chinese object. I was thinking of an egg. Is very fragile.
Let's call the egg the Chinese object. Yes, but it is that emotion of touching something that you have the chance to touch once in a lifetime, that has been touched by people in history, that has a value, not a economic value, which it has, but a value of continuity in time.
A root value, yes.
A spiritual value, you are touching history. Mm-hmm. So, if it is an object that is local, a wamon, called a normal object, you take it with one hand because there is enough safety with one hand. And with the same grace, you'd bring it toward you, maybe at a little higher height because it is more safe. And you'll carry it this way. So, learning how to do that, at the beginning, it's a rule. You learn the rule. And there are thousands is not enough, millions of rules on how to properly behave in the summer, in the autumn, in the winter, in the spring, in the morning, at night, with friends of certain position. There are rules, and when all these rules are understood in the sense of discovered without questions, you realize that there is no rule. It's just common sense. So it is this common sense that you have to achieve.
Yeah? We have no common sense from the beginning.
I think that we don't.
Okay, yes.
That,
yes.
I'm a little daring in saying this, but we lost it being focused on other things today. Mm-hmm. So we go to exotic places to discover how to eat at the table, how to properly sit on a seat, how to converse with another person in front of you. We don't know how to do that anymore in the what I call proper way. Until you learn all that, yes. And you saying that we learn the entire tradition coming from the way of behaving in the temple, the way of behaving in an aristocratic way, to a way of behaving like a recluse, wise person, a monk, a very clever, very educated person who understands the emptiness or the nothingness of that which appeared to be oneness, and the oneness of that which appears to be nothingness, and being relaxed, being calm, withdraws himself from the world. And he saw how tea ceremony formed in the backyards of merchants, the layer in between temple and in between excess. They said, we have to bring this at the right way, at the middle way of decency, remote from the noise of the day-to-day and the temptations. I call it noise, let's not call it temptation, the noise of day-to-day, in a space where you can hear while you talk the boiling of the water, when you can feel your heart as you talk, when you feel that you can talk with a person in front of you without saying a word. Because we have so many ways of conveying our state of mind outside our routine of speaking, which I do right now.
Beautiful, thank you. So maybe it's the proper time to start You've already started, but yes. Since to begin the tea ceremony.
A little demonstration.
A little demonstration, and Christina will be.
Christina will be the first guest in the tea room. Everybody is equal, and yet there are hierarchical categories. She will be the first in the sense that she probably knows more, so she will guide other people. She'll be the first guest, Shokyaku, and you'll be the second, Jikyaku, the second person. So I will make tea for you and her, and you'll enjoy the tea, I hope. Yeah. So what happens here is maybe a little bit, it is the right way to do it with this type of table. It's the tradition called Ryurei, but there are niche alterations which we decided to make so that the process is smooth and takes a shorter time. So, on the table, one thing that does not belong is my glass of water. So I will ask maybe Christina if you be so nice and remove it. And before I start, I just displayed the objects, and I will put them in the proper way. So I just wanted to briefly describe what happens here. We have the kettle that boils quietly without asking questions. We have a, it's called hishaku, it's a ladle of taking the water. We have hot water and we have cold water because a certain temperature has to be sometime balanced. Sometime. We have a support, futaoki. We have a bowl, chawan. We have natsume, kinjinji natsume is the container that contains the tea powder that is used for the tea. We have a little object to make the broth, the frothing the tea inside to bring it to a sort of a cappuccino look-alike, tipuccino look-alike. And we have an object, chashaku, to take the tea out. So all these objects have to be perfectly pure before they are brought in. And they are right now perfectly pure. But in order to, when you are going to dig the tea, you'll see that you'll rotate many times the bowl this way. And there is a reason for that the bowl, like you, like me, like anything else, has a front and a back. And we talk to the object that we hold is face to face. But when it'll come to you, the face will be turned toward you. So it is a sense, a consequence of respect. But the respect should be there not because you want to show the consequence, because it is there. So we went into this. Okay, so saying that, inside I will put and a very fresh cotton piece called chakin that will be used to clean the objects, right? So this chakin will have to be eventually dried. And wiped. This is just to show what it is and put inside. I have everything already prepared, so just put it. So saying that, I'll take the chakin that is already here. And I will come and salute you. The host and the guests are exchanging greetings, or I salute them. When they do that, they basically commit themselves to helping each other from the bottom of their hearts. Then the host, or teishu, takes a general look and gains concentration. He moves chawan and natsume, the tea bowl and the container of tea, in front of him for purifying them. Everything is already pure. This one is a symbolic purification and it's really dusting the dust that does not exist. the dust that really covers our hearts, our natural sincerity. So the natsume in the container is clean. The next is chashaku, the bamboo spoon used to add tea in a bowl. As natsume and chashaku have been cleaned, the issue has to purify the bowl, and to do that he needs water. Therefore, after moving the bowl closer to him, he will open the kamandi, the lid of the vessel in which water boils. And rather, it's at a temperature of 90 degrees. An immaculate white cloth, jakin, used to wipe the bowl is moved outside so that the host can add water. The movements must be natural. Any excess of artistic contouring is considered a bad taste. Negligence is not good, but too much emphasis on the artistic part is also not good. Somewhere in between, where it is natural. So the chasen is cleaned. So the bowl is now wiped clean and dry, ready to receive the tea. As tea is added, both the host and the guest really plunge deep and deeper in a state of contemplative meditation. The host asks the guest to share the sweets prior to drinking the tea, so the bitterness of the tea combines in a tasteful way with the sweetness of the sweets that they have before. Two spoons of tea are added. The guests are sharing the tea, the sweets. The lid of the container of cold water is removed. And as you can see, sometimes it is a challenge as the surface of the table just fights against it. The temperature of water was just proper by Teishu. So he adds directly hot water for the tea, CHANOYU. That is the meaning of CHANOYU. And the gesture with which hishaku is put signifies the gesture that one uses when the arrow leaves the bow in a contest of archery. So the tea is agitated until it becomes like a very smooth froth, like a cappuccino. That
Tipuchin, probably.
The ball is turned, so the face of the ball now is on the other side, because the guest in this particular case will receive the tea from the teisho, from the host, directly. Usually this is done by a second person, a hanto. So now the face of the bowl is toward teisho, he turns it again so that the face is toward the guests. A bow is exchanged, and the deepest sincere consideration for the moment, the one moment in a lifetime, the ichigo, ichi. The next ceremony will be certainly different.
Thank you very much for the tea.
Shokyaku, the first guest, praises the moment and then sips the tea. She is satisfied and wants to communicate that to the host. Usually three sips, or more as necessary, are taken, so that all the tea is enjoyed. After drinking, the guest has an urge to look at the object she drank from. It is a high quality, sometimes antique, piece of ceramic, and it is worthwhile observing and touching and understanding its life. And questions may be asked to the teisho regarding the origin of this particular piece of ceramic. After the expected salute, the teisho takes the bowl and will prepare another tea for the second guest. And this process can continue several times. There are situations where maybe 5-6 bowls are drunk by each of the guests to continue to enjoy the moment of withdrawal from the everyday's noise and vicissitudes. So, just as the first time the bowl is cleaned and the second tea is prepared. Also, two spoons, also with the water that is of proper temperature. In case the water is now too hot, the teisho may add cold water to the kettle, please, so that the proper temperature of the water is maintained. That is the reason why he had to open the receptacle, the ceramic receptacle on his right, mizusashi. The second guest enjoys the sweets, and if there are questions, the first guest is there to help. The name of the sweets is okashi. So far you have seen two ways of returning that ishaku on the kettle. The regular way and the way when the tea is made, like now. They have different names and different symbolics and ranking. Usually there are three main ranks in the practice of tea and in the Japanese culture. And these are so, the ordinary one, gyo, the middle, and shin, the superior. And their appearance as shin, gyo, or so depends on the type of temae of the exercise to prepare the tea, the symbolics of the objects, as they all together form a micro-universe. There are the Taoist rules that apply to the creation of this micro-universe. And the second bowl is offered to the guests. We'll notice, and a bit too late, that the Izhu has prepared for the guest a scroll in the tokonoma, in the altar, and on that scroll he selected a particular calligraphy.
And you can take this one, little gesture of thanking for the fact that this happens now.
Chisoku, which means,
and then you take three, four,
what
six.
You have is sufficient. In a poetic and more more popular way, it can be read as the orange. If you squeeze it too much into hard, the juice becomes sour and bitter. So the guest properly appreciates the novelty of the taste of tea
the bowl and, the ceramic
and appreciates the moment. Next to the calligraphy, which symbolizes the eternal act, the forever the philosophical part, there is an arrangement of flowers, which is the ephemeral, the temporary one, the one that comes and goes. And the flowers represent, symbolize the nature, the particular season, the particular moment. They are alive only for this ceremony. And the Izhu puts the flowers in the vase as he finds it, quote unquote, as he finds them on the field. The arrangement is called chabana, and it is different from ikebana, which is an artistic exercise. As the host continues to make tea, Shokyaku, the first guest, asked for the session to be finished. So Teishu will purify, will clean this time the instruments, and will put them in the original place. And that was the third type of movement after adding the cold water. Everything is the same, and yet there is a different life to the second part of the ceremony after the tea has been finished. It is not faster, but a sense of immediate frugality is added to it. We are slowly coming back to the normal life, and this has to be felt in the way Teishu continues to prepare the ending of the temai. Such skills for acquiring techniques for creating that mood of coming back from the journey take years to be acquired. So the objects or dogu are put back in place, and cold water is added.
This time it symbolizes the end of the temae. Tea ceremony is really about enjoying the moment to its fullest, with full heart. So Teishu stands up and thanks the guests for the honor to be there to enjoy a cup of tea offered by him.
Asta first.
This is it.
Asta suspune.
This is it. This so, is it. If I my first impressions are the field, the intersubjective field, and so on that I experience, and the details and the rhythm have nothing to do with the European rush hours, which are permanent.
True, self-evident, I would say. Yes.
And I was thinking that. European rush hour hard-minded people can not even tolerate this kind of, you know, of speed, natural speed.
When it was developed, they had the same thoughts, although the life was much, much slower. But the merchants said, it is impossible to stay on the noise of the outside, of the business of moving merchandise, mm-hmm. of seeing clowns and warriors and dust mm-hmm. and anger. So let's remove ourselves to a place where we can develop this common sense of simplicity. What we do here has somehow a lot to do with a concept of wabi, which is wabi-sabi, which is a sense of a refined simplicity. It is a very complex and very difficult concept. But yes, it was the idea of withdrawing in a space in which you can be closer with yourself, your senses can perceive what is apparently not you in a different way, at a different pace. While we are challenged to live in today's world and we try to continue this type of state of mind, withdrawing is good, it's like sleeping. Progressing spiritually is good, but I think oscillating between sleep and wake and noise, sleep and wake, is not necessarily the way that we want to progress. We want to feel continuously this state of mind.
As I feel it, yes. It's beyond culture and times and specifics of kind of, you know, groups or so on, because the simplicity and the refined simplicity, it's a, I don't know, dimension compulsory for the modern complex mind people in order to rebalance himself. This is, I think, the speed of a growing seed. This is the speed,
its own speed, yes.
Of the season, of seasons,
that's true.
Of the rising sun and so on. This is our cellular speed. I think all the disease are the consequence of
forcing this speed, yes. Willingly or unwillingly. Mm-hmm. It is true, the sun doesn't rush to rise or go back. Doesn't know that it does, mm-hmm. So yes, trying to develop, not consciously, to develop that connection to the rhythm that is out there that is good for you. But do not read me as preaching this as a healing instrument.
But I thought of this in implicitly healing instrument.
Yes, that's why I replied at your thought. It is implicitly that. But we are not pursuing that. On the contrary, we try to develop the understand, not the understand, to develop a sense of not pursuing the convenient, the comfort, the living longer or being healthier. These are things that are very en vogue. Mm-hmm. They always were, and there's nothing wrong with being healthy. Mm-hmm. But the moment you pursue being healthy, there is a cost for that, that you try to ignore in order to continue to pursue being healthy. Yes. So I think that pursuing is not necessarily the way forward, but flowing with is the way to be. Flowing with. And the question is, with what? And we are practicing without asking questions. And that's it. And perhaps sometime that flowing with what will come to us.
Unfortunately, we only have 3 minutes.
3 minutes.
And I'm glad that we already plan in Spirit University a conference about flowing, in fact. Christina, maybe a word. What have brought to you learning from sensei and having this meeting with a great tradition?
Thank you for your question. Too many for 3 minutes, but I'll try to be quick. There is this state of being present that is very important for me in my practice. Continuously trying to be coordinated in everything that I do and really be there. Apart from that, is a lot about history and culture. And this is really a long discussion. It's very complex and it brings a lot, really. And just together with him, I feel like I'm practicing for 12 years, so we builded many together, many things in tea, and I've learned a lot. It's like a growing up process for me. But this peaceful and being present is, let's say, something really touchable for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gabriel, please have the last minute, I think, and a half of our program, maybe with a word of concluding and something that passed through your mind.
Yes. Well, I'm already feeling very empowered. I have the last minute. There isn't much that I can say. What we have to do, maybe, or I think we have to do that, is to grow on our own responsibility to look inside us, not outside. I think that looking for teachers, in that sense, looking for wisdom coming from somebody, maybe like me, it is not the way. But practicing together and just practicing without questioning anything is the way in which someone, anyone in any culture, practicing, not necessarily tea, but practicing without questions and with faith, with conviction that is doing the right thing and things will come, will bring people to that perception of the flow and being one with the rest in a way that is perceived as prosperous, healthy, everything that comes on the part of materialistic things. This is not materialistic. This is the beauty at work, and it is an experience and cannot be intellectually conveyed. So thank you very much for the chance of sharing a cup of tea with you.
Thank you again, Gabriel Caciula. Thank you, Christina.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
See you next time and next year.
Thank you so much for
inviting us. Thank you.